very good point. And I didn't have that on my list.
Okay.
Awesome. I should have remembered that. Welcome. And it's just wonderful to see the size of family and look how well organized they are and sorted out, and it's amazing. We're here to celebrate and grieve for the passing of Gary, and everybody here knew Gary in some fashion, and I believe we're the better for it by a long ways. A couple of housekeeping things. Cassie just reminded me, cell phones off, if that's, which I better do mine. Good point. Anyway, it's just so helpful when you do that. It's appreciated. My name is Dale Kuhn. I'm going to kind of MC things. I'm going to go through a few housekeeping things. First, I want to welcome people that are online. I know Laura wanted to stream this. There's people that can't be here. So that does affect a few things how we do. When we're streaming, they can't see anything past there that way. So if you are asked or you feel that you want to come up and say something, please come up to the podium or come up at least on stage, because they cannot participate if we're down there. And for those of you online, we apologize. There's some songs that aren't licensed to put on the internet, so you might miss that, but we do apologize ahead of time, but it's just the way the world works today. We expect to be an hour at most, depending how talkative I guess everybody is. The family would love if you would stay afterwards. There's some food, lots of food from what I could see there. And just sit down and spend some time with people you know or haven't seen for a while, and let's share some memories. Let's talk about the good times and maybe hug somebody's shoulder and have a good cry if that's what you need. And that's just what we're here for. So a couple of things. There's washrooms spread around the building, some in the back, some on this side if you need to slip out. And if you feel like you want to come up and say something, we will have an open mic. And if it's not something you're comfortable doing by yourself, give somebody a nudge or the sign and get them to come with you. Or if you see somebody that needs some help, give them a hand. Come on up here, put your arm around their shoulder and give them some support, because this isn't necessarily a comfortable thing for any of us. But that, I think that would be appreciated. And I'll speak for Laura, the family the family is very glad that you came. It's just nice to see. Gary knew so many people from so many different aspects of his life. For me, I've known Gary for many, many years, and there's two things that jump out to me when I think of Gary Giese. One is it's just his love for people. I mean, you could see that in everything he did and every part of him. And he was one of those people that when you were talking to him, he was all in. I mean, he was fully engaged in listening to you and really wanting to know what you had to say. And that's amazing to me. Those are the first two things. We could go on, but that's the first two things that always came to me when I thought of Gary Giese is just his love for people and care for them. So. We'll start with a prayer. And dear Lord, we just want to thank you for Gary. We want to thank you for his life. We want to thank you for all those people that he affected. We want to thank you for his faith. I know you're a God of grace and forgiveness and peace. And we ask your blessings on this day and on those that are here. Support them, strengthen them, give them comfort, give them peace. Help them with their grieving. And Lord, would you and bless those that have stepped up and helped and made this thing all together. So in Jesus' name, amen. Gary. Right now, Gary's going to come up and do the eulogy. And come on up, sir.
Morning, everyone. I'm Gary Giese Jr., son of the original Gary Giese that brought us all here today. I want to thank you all for coming here today to honor and remember my dad and celebrate the life he lived, because it was a good one. I've never given a eulogy before. There's no words or a ceremony that could describe or honor my father and what he meant to me and my family, but today we'll give it our best shot. My dad moved out on his own as a teenager, apprenticing as a mechanic. He spent his time pulling wrenches and drag racing his Camaro. And after that era, he sold his tools and his car, bought a Ibanez guitar and a half-stack Marshall amp, became a musician for a living, played in a band called Pressure. He had the tight, bright-colored pants, long hair, the whole nine yards. I imagine the attention he got from the ladies playing in a band had a big part to that decision, but his love for music and guitar stayed with him his whole life. His love for music and guitars has already been passed down generations as well. It'll probably be passed down for generations to come. We thought we'd display his guitars here. That dark acoustic he played as a young man and taught me to play when I was a kid. It's older than me. Gave it to me when I moved out. It's probably the only thing I gave much sentimental value to. After the musician years, he went on to drive a logging truck, playing in a band, didn't really pay much bills, so he said he had to take the test to become a, get his class one like five times because the guy didn't like him and he didn't like his long hair. It was probably business on top, but a bit too much party in the back for that guy's liking. Remnants of the band days, but he passed it. He was a pretty stubborn, hard-headed guy, but in a good way. He wasn't gonna roll over and take the failure. He was gonna keep at it until he succeeded, and that work ethic stayed with him till the end. Some years later, the white-collar life looked appealing to him. He started a career as a salesman in the steel industry. Did very well at that. He was still he was doing outside sales in the steel industry until last year. And years ago, for a long stint as well, he had a network marketing business on top of the sales job. He always made time for his family, but he worked hard. The amount of coffee that man drank back in the day was staggering. It's probably what led to the abnormal amount of sleepwalking I witnessed growing up. Sleepwalking kind of runs in the family, but my dad took it to a whole nother level. He usually had a house coat on, which was fortunate, but not always. One night, I was at the front door. I just said goodbye to my girlfriend, and she had just left, luckily. And I turn around, and here he comes down the stairs, butt naked. I'm like, Dad, go back to bed, man. What are you doing? I gotta make my coffee. Then in the morning, like many mornings, he'd wonder why the coffee was cold. He had the timer set and everything. Like, yeah, must need a new coffee pot. And then later in life, he becomes a cowboy, riding horses, working machinery and tractors, quadding, throwing hay bales around. Just a regular outdoorsman. I did not see that coming growing up. It was quite the contrast from the man I watched. But it suited him well. If it wasn't for the cancer, I think he would live a much longer life. There was no more sleepwalking. He was active, learning, smiling, laughing, just staying young. His happy marriage is a big part of that as well. With his sense of humor and his work ethic and his warm smile and attentive nature, he found success wherever he went. And that iconic laugh of his, too. Can't have his eulogy without mentioning that unique laugh of his. Didn't matter where you were, how big of a crowd you were in, you were not going to lose my dad. If he was around people, there's going to be some regular laughs coming out of him, so you just had to wait a bit. Wait and listen, and then it's like, pow, there's my dad over there. Big, booming laugh come rising out of the crowd. And there was no mistaking it, that was him. Like, Dad's over there, right? When he was younger, he said he was walking into a house with a couple of friends of his, and they're talking and, of course, laughing with my dad. And as he walks in, he's laughing, and his laugh comes right back and hits him right back. So that was kind of weird. He laughed again because it was weird. Right, he hears his laugh come right back at him again. His friend had a parrot upstairs. That bird didn't skip a beat. Probably never heard anything like that in his life. He's going to try that noise out right away. Where my dad really shined was with his family and his friends. He was an amazing father, grandfather, son, brother, and friend to many, and husband. I think he did a bit better at the husband thing on the second attempt, but that was all right. But yeah, he was just the best. And as a dad, as my dad, I couldn't imagine any better. Always looked up to him. As most of you are aware, I was an absolute angel growing up. My sister too. But there were some mistakes made. But no matter how big I messed up, he wasn't yelling or screaming or even angry. Maybe a bit of the disappointed treatment and a warranted grounding, but he was just there to help and lean on, to give guidance. He'd do things like, give me a book, tell me to read this book and give him a book report on it, you know, and he'd pick exactly what I needed to get me back on track. And that was the easy stuff. On and on it went to adulthood, fatherhood. He was always there to lean on, to lend a helping hand, give advice. Reminds me of that song, I'm an adult now. I don't drink just to spite my parents. I think I'll call my dad up and invite him. The father-son relationship was always there, but in the later years, it was a friendship as well that was invaluable. He left me with a lot of wisdom. Wish he would have left me with that full head of hair he had. He's 66, multiple cancer battles, and didn't do anything to his hairline. But it wasn't just me he left an impression on. He was just great with people. Family, friends, coworkers, acquaintances, it didn't matter. He was just a genuine, upfront, honest guy. And he really listened to you. He'd look you in the eye and listen to you. He showed he cared about you, and he cared about what you had to say. Near the end, when we found out there was nothing left to be done to fight the cancer, he took the news better than anyone. He wasn't complaining or angry or resentful or even that sad. He was just brave, faithful, and strong-minded regardless of his body or the cancer in it. He was just thankful for the great life he lived, full of love and family. It was pretty impressive, really inspiring even. Squeezed out a little bit more guidance and wisdom without having to say another word. He kept saying how lucky he was to have such a loving family and friends. His hospital room was busy every day he was sick. But it was his own love and devotion that he freely gave to others being given back to him. He was taken too soon, but he lived a great life. He left a lasting impression on everyone in his life. And he left the world a better place than he found it. I'm so thankful and blessed to not just have known him, but to have him as a father and a best friend, and to have been so close to him my whole life. He's truly irreplaceable, and we're all going to miss him. My dad wanted a few songs played at his funeral. This one's called Time. Who's it by, sorry?
Dean Brody.
Dean Brody. I think they're pretty sad songs, but he picked them, so you're going to all have to deal with it.
Thank you.
was not the easiest thing to do. He did well. Gary had a strong faith, and glad for that. That is, I just want to say, read to you a psalm, one you're probably very familiar with, and I would ask that you can certainly read along with me, because I think you know the words just as well as I do. Psalm 23. Oh, that was a... Sorry. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We're going to do some family stories. I think you guys are coming up. And then there'll be a song, and then I just want you to give some thought. Maybe there's a story or something short that you want to remember Gary by. Just maybe give that some thought and come on up after. Are you ready?
Thank you, everybody, for coming today. So wonderful to see all your faces. And thank you to all the wonderful people that helped to put our luncheon together. Gary was my best friend. God really blessed us when he brought us together. We were so connected emotionally, mentally, spiritually, and physically, we were one. We even had the same sense of humor. We were constantly laughing about something. And a lot of times we even finished each other's sentences. Got kind of sickening, I guess you could think. We could talk about anything with each other and everything. We shared all our secrets and our dreams. We also shared a love for our Heavenly Father, who we both talked to and about. Every day of our life together, we were always amazed and so grateful for all the amazing blessings he bestowed upon us, each and every day. And one of those days was our wedding day, July 11th, 2011. That year, I don't think there was one day here or there that it didn't rain. And that day was no different. While Gary and a few helpers, and I think Jeff was one of them. Where is he? I can't see him. We're moving the wedding arch first outside, then inside, without getting it wet. I was totally oblivious to the turmoil. I had never been so happy and worry-free. It didn't matter to me by then where it happened. I just knew that it would happen no matter what. We pledged our love to each other in our little house with a few friends and family, and our beautiful life began as husband and wife. Oh, by the way, the sun did come out. That was that blessing again. And we were able to have beautiful pictures on the deck because the arch was once again moved outside. It was perfect. And we danced the night away. When we first got together, Gary hadn't experienced a lot of outdoor activities. But it wasn't long before he appreciated the outdoors almost as much as me. He said it brought back a lot of memories of his childhood when he would spend hours exploring the forests around Terrace. Gary fell in love with the horses and learned how to ride. Well, sort of. John Wayne, he wasn't. Our favorite place to ride was at the Spruce Hills in Hunter Mile. Gary loved the rolling hills of that place, and we would dream of having a property that could boast a rolling hill or two. We spent a lot of our summers camping at Tabor Lake, where we shared a property, and he loved to keep it looking good. When we were planning a family get-together, which was pretty often out there, Gary and I would get out there before anyone else, and he would mow the lawn on his ride-on lawnmower with either a coffee or a beer in the cup holder, just happy, happy. We were able to get away a few times to both sides of Mexico also, where we both enjoyed the sun, surf, and an excursion or two, and always a few nights of dancing. And I was just remembering this morning, too, Disneyland. That man loved Disneyland. He was just like a kid. I'll never forget him coming off of the roller. I wouldn't go on the roller coaster with him, but he'd go on the roller coaster all by himself, and he'd come off, his hair like, and he was just like, wahoo! He loved Disneyland and the roller coaster. So by summer of 2018, our prayers for country property were finally answered. And on August 8th, we moved to our amazing country estate at 3600 Sunshine Crescent. Well, to us, it was an estate. It might have only been 7.5 acres, but it was an estate. It was just so surreal. We'd wake up every morning and we'd look out at our beautiful front yard and deck off the bedroom, and then we'd go downstairs and then there's a big deck at the back and we could look out all over our beautiful yard, and he loved sitting out there just looking over the place. We were finally able to bring our horses home to live with us. There was a tremendous amount of work to be done, but it was a total labor of love. Gary's focus from the moment we moved out there was to make that place shine and to set it up to be self-sufficient, which he did. He was also determined to make our pasture with its one rolling hill into a golf course. And he managed that too. Yeah, and thrown in there for good measure was his construction of an outside riding arena. The hours and hours he spent on that tractor, removing the topsoil and smoothing the ground with just the right grade. And I know that he did that just for me. He finished it the year after his victory over throat cancer. In between all the work, we enjoyed playtime with the horses, quads, or just standing on the upper deck. We hardly went out anymore. We didn't have to. We were living on a resort. Often we would just crank up the tunes and dance on the rug. Though he would rather be playing music and singing, which he did on many occasions, he would dance because He knew how much I loved to dance, and he would do it for me. He would always look forward to having both our families together for celebrations. The house would ring with voices and be overflowing with love, laughter, and always a song. His heart would be so full. Answered prayers and dreams coming true. Once we were advised in November that Gary may not have long to live, he wanted to make Christmas, this last Christmas, the best that it could be with all our family together. And it was wonderful. Shortly after, Gary was in and out of the hospital, but was able to come home for his birthday and stay home. Family and friends came to visit. Junior and Tracy were there every day. The day before Gary died, we were in the family room together, and there was nobody in the house at the time, and he was quite restless but very weak. I turned the TV on for a distraction for him. There was an airing of a live performance at the Grand Ole Opry. There was a performer that was doing a rendition of The Dance by Garth Brooks. As the lyrics of the song were sung, the words rang true with so much meaning for us. We looked at each other with tears in our eyes, and I moved to the side of his bed, and with our arms around each other, we sobbed. So yes, I wish we could have missed the pain, but I wouldn't have wanted to have missed the dance. Our time together on this earth was short, but it was nothing short of amazing. I would do it all over again, even if I knew how it was going to end. And one day, I know I will see him again. Thank you.
love with instantly. And a lot of the reason was because just what everybody was saying about how loyal he was and how happy he was and how friendly he was. Man, I tell you, that guy, I took him to meetings with me with Kickstand Development Corporation, and I've seen somebody sitting there listening, being respectful, feeling like he was out of his league. But at the end of the meeting, I told Gary, I said, you know, they're out of your league because you show so much loyalty, so much care, so much compassion. I said, and I love that about you, you know? And I just wanted to get up here and thank the family for sharing him with me. I seen him several months ago, and he said, Calvin, come on, we gotta go for coffee, we gotta catch up, we gotta, you know, there's just so much I wanna see, you know, how's your life doing, blah, 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 because I just recently got married last July. And, you know, and I wanted to so bad, I wanted to connect with him. And then, of course, you know, you move back to Hazleton, and I haven't seen him for quite a while, and I'm not a Facebook guy. I don't like going on Facebook, but for some reason, I'm scrolling on Facebook, and then, of course, I see, you know, Gary passed, and my heart just dropped, you know, because, you know, you always say to yourself, don't overlook the time that you can have with people, and that's what he would tell you, you know, because I should have took that opportunity. You always feel that way, you know, but it was a way for him telling me that, hey, you can come and still see me, you know, and I just felt so honored about it, how everything worked out. I was here for a Aboriginal hockey tournament for my seven-year-old, I should say, and just the way the schedule worked out, it worked out perfect. You know, I was able to be here, and I wanted to be here so bad, you know, but I just want to thank the family for sharing him with me, because he was a great man, and he'll never be forgotten. You know, I'll always remember him. I'll always remember his laughs. I'll always remember his loyalty, and I'll always remember how great of a man he was. He taught me a lot about compassion, loyalty, and how you treat people. You treat people how you want to be treated. And he always did that, no matter what situation we're in. And I just want to say thank you and allowing me this opportunity to be here and share the great memories of him, because he was a great man. Thank you.
Something stirring, any of you want to talk about? Come on up. Here comes Byron.
I'm going to try and get through this. If I look like a chipmunk, I got a cough candy in each cheek. If you're worried about it being contagious, it's not. It's from other causes. I met Gary, I think it's probably about 25 years ago. And Gary was selling steel at the time. And I was working for a company, and I loved it when he came in. And you've all mentioned his smile and his laugh. And it was very, very contagious. And then one day, Gary and I went for lunch at the Carmel. And our lives changed. Okay, and together we got involved in network marketing, okay, which Gary Jr. mentioned. And one of the things about network marketing was that the personal development was paramount. And I never met anybody like Gary that was a sponge for knowledge and for changing his life. Okay, and you know, it was so fun to watch, and it was so fun to be a part of it. And I'm going to say Gary and I have become very, very close friends. You know, as time went on, we kind of went our separate ways a little bit. But it didn't matter if I hadn't seen him for 6 months, 3 months, a year. When we got together, there was a bond there, and it was like no other. And you immediately felt the connection. And we could sit and talk about anything. I'm going to tell a story that, and some of you have maybe heard it before, but it really struck me when I heard it first. And some of you know who Tommy Lasorda is. Okay, he was a coach of the Dodgers. And one night he was on Larry King Live. And he had just lost his 33-year-old son to a massive heart attack. And at the same time, there was another celebrity that had also lost his son. But he turned to the alcohol and eventually ended up dying from it. And so Larry King asked Tommy Lasorda, he said, "So what's the difference?" He said, "You know, you both lost your sons, but two completely different outcomes." And Tommy Lasorda said, "I had my faith, and that got us through." And he said, if God had said to us 33 years ago, "We're going to give you this little boy, but you can only have him for 33 years," we would have took him in a heartbeat, he said, because we have 33 years of wonderful, wonderful, wonderful memories. And you know, as sad as I am that we've lost Gary, and it's going to be hard, but you know, I am so grateful that he came into my life, and I'm so grateful for all the memories that I have of him, and I will cherish those forever.
Okay. Oh, yeah, Ryan, awesome. You gonna bring your partner with you, or no?
Wasn't expected to do this.
It's that black thing.
I remember the first time I met Gary. I'll never forget it. I was just young, looking for opportunities, and like Byron was sharing, first time I met him, it was just like, he just felt love. He just, you know, first time I ever learned what a man hug was. He'd just grab your hand, and he'd be like, "Hey, you know," and give you a big hug, and I was just like, "What's this?" You know, it's like, never. This is crazy. Right? This is strange stuff, right? But man, it sure wore on you. And yeah, and then, you know, introducing me to guys like Byron and Dale and Leslie Kuhn and Dean and Elvie Burks and Lonnie and Narissa Anderson and just so many people. Just so many people that just had an incredible passion to make a difference in people's lives. And yeah, it transformed me. Like Gary Jr. was saying, he'd see something that you needed in your life and he'd give you a book for it. "Here, give this book, you know, a shot. You'll really like it." Yeah, and you'd read the book, and you're like, you know, and you'd find out your personal relationships with others just got better. They just got better. And it's almost like it was like magic, but it was just, you know, from the relationships that he had developed with others and the personal growth that he'd gone through. So, and I just wanted to share my little bit of experience with him, and thank you guys all too as well for coming. And I had no idea that my mom would end up marrying him and making an even greater impact on everyone's life. an immense impact on my mom's life. And you know, they were really good friends, and extremely good friends, which you don't see often in marriages, very often is the friendship. And it can happen. It's a real thing. And his faith was strong. It was amazing to see him in his last few days, last couple weeks of living. Looked like he had zero fear. Like, zero fear. It's like he had crazy amount of peace that I've never even seen in somebody before, like Gary was sharing, how he was squeezing out a little bit more life lessons. But the peace that he had when he had come to terms with everything, and he had just incredible peace. You just look at him, and it was just like, it was like he was directly connected to the source of life. It was just crazy. Like, he just had incredible peace, and he knew where he was going, and who he was going to be with. So just thank you guys all for being here, and thank you for the opportunity to share.
Show them how that's done. Show them how that's done. All right, Ryan.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you very much. Anybody else? Yeah, come on. And you know, when you have something to say, there's somebody in this room that needs to hear what you say. So it's.
I appreciate that.
Hi, I'm Larry, Laura's brother. And I just met Gary soon after Laura met him, and we hit it off right off the bat, and because he's always so friendly and had such an infectious laugh, and he was always great to talk to, and we even hit it off well enough that he even came to see me in the dental office, and he says his goal is to whiten up his smile and remove the evidence of his previous smoking. And took us a little while, but we finally achieved that, and he was so enormously thankful every visit. And he always left with a smile, even though part of his lips were a bit frozen. But and then all our family get-togethers, we would sit and exchange all the events that went on in between, and discuss our faith with the Lord, and he was there right up to the end with his faith, sharing it with his family, so positive, and no serious regrets. He was always thankful. Right to the end, and I'll surely miss him.
Thank you.
We're doing great. We're doing great. Come on up.
Hello, everyone. Obviously, if you guys took the rest of the week off, then I could tell you all the stories I have about Gary, but we don't have that much time. I'm too short for it.
There we go.
Okay. I met Gary in 2017. I was applying for my first inside sales job in the steel industry. I knew nothing about it. I was Googling on my way there and not while driving. So I knew he needed an edge, and I was hoping he was a dog lover, so I put my St. Bernard in the truck with me, parked outside the front of the building with the windows down, so that if I looked like I didn't know what I was doing, at least I had a cute dog. And after 15 minutes of leaving that interview, I got the phone call that I was hired, and I burst out into tears. I was so happy. And just his excitement giving me the job was so awesome. There's a lot of stories I can tell, but he's definitely missed. And getting to know his beautiful wife, Laura, and his family and whatnot, it's going to be a void that can't be filled. So I know I have a lot more to say, but I kind of forgot it once the lights were on me. So, but yeah, as everyone else said, thank you for sharing him with us. He was always a listening ear, definitely looked at you when you were speaking, not listening to respond. And he's going to be very missed.
So how are we doing? There we go.
So my name's Beth. I worked with Gary off and on for the last 27 years. And I wanted to thank him for teaching me how to multitask. This is going to be a quick, funny little story. The first time I went on an outside sales call was with Gary to Fort St. James. And he was driving, it was pouring rain, he had his planner out, doing about 100, had a coffee going, making notes, and he could have possibly been smoking at the same time, I'm not sure. I was in the passenger side, slightly terrified, but it got a little worse. He decided he was going to pass a logging truck, we were a little tight on time. So I said, Gary, is there anything I can help you with? He's like, no, Bev, I got this, hair straight back. And that was always his favorite saying, and I'll never forget it. And he will leave a void with the AJ family for sure. That's it.
Thank you. That's awesome. That is awesome. You bet. We doing okay out there? Yeah. Well, if there is, come on up. Yeah. It's always tricky. Appreciate that.
So I'm Gary's sister, Deborah, and I just too far away. I'm Gary's sister, Deborah, and I just would like to tell a brief story. A Buck in his younger days, when young Gary was telling you all about his band days, and he used to play in a rock concert and have his band together. And we grew up in Terrace. And when he came back from the band in the summertime, I met him, I think it was about June. And he was so thin, and the band had disbanded by then. He had given it up. He made a final decision, and I saw him on the street, and he was so thin. And I said, Gary, I said, you've got to get some meat on you. And he said, oh, Deb, he said, I've been just surviving on canned tuna. He said, we were just barely making ends meet with the band, and I lost so much weight. So it wasn't long after that he moved in with us. We were renting a big old drafty house at the time. And I told him he was welcome to come and just bunk in for the summer and get back on his feet. And in true Gary fashion, by the end of the summer, I don't even think it was September, he already had got a job lined up. He had an apartment, and he had a new girlfriend. So it didn't take him long from June to, I think it must have been the first week of September, and he moved out, and he had gained some weight, and he was, you know, he never lost a beat. He was smiling, he was there, but he wasn't there with us. He was always independent, and that was in true Gary fashion, and I just wanted to share that with you, and we'll all miss him. We'll always miss Gary. Thanks.
All right. This is great. I mean, this is what we're here for. And I would encourage you to continue this. And we're gonna do some slideshows and get some memories going. And then we'll wrap this up. And you guys will get together, do some chat amongst yourselves, tell some stories. It'll be all good. So we'll do some slideshows.
were both like close together, a few miles apart inside. Was it something I said or something I did? Did my words not come out right? Though I tried not to hurt you, though I tried. Guess that's why they say a rose has its wound. Just like every night has its dawn. Just like every cowboy sings a sad, sad song. Every rose has its own. Yes, it does.
Tyler, that was, he did a lot of that. Imagine there was some collaboration, but you're the man. Awesome, thank you. I appreciate that. What's that?
He traded sleep for that.
There you go, I bet you did, yeah. It's amazing. All right, well, traditionally I write things down for to talk, but I didn't put anything down to close us out. Didn't know what I was going to want to say. And I think you guys have said it all. I think those of you that have come up and spoke, the memories it's created, that the videos and the songs have created, I think that's enough. We're still going to celebrate Gary's life. He's not going to be forgotten. And every time you hear something or see something that reminds you of him, it's okay to give it a thought. And yeah, tell him you miss him. Anyway, it's all good. One more song we'll end with, The Living Years. And then I would ask that, yeah, come on out to the back. These people put together an amazing feast back there. So let's eat and be merry and cry on somebody's shoulder and tell a story and have a good time. Thank you. just say a quick grace for the meal, and if you guys want to follow the family out, that would be awesome. Dear Lord, we just thank you so much for the gift of life, for the gift of Gary, and all that he's meant to all of us. We thank you for being with everybody, guiding them, giving them peace. We ask you to bless this meal before us and the hands that made it. Amen.